The Philippine Venture Capital Report 2020 says despite the COVID-19 health and economic crisis, venture capital funding in the Philippines, at the early stage level at least, managed to spike in the first half of the year to nearly $52 million, beating 2019 performance, but still lagging behind 2018's record $110 million. Joining us now to talk more about the venture capital landscape in Manila is Mark Koojiman of Foxmont Capital Partners. Hi, Mark. Good morning.
Good morning, Michelle.
Okay, so just to clarify, the big spike that we saw in the January to June period this year, it's primarily driven by one big transaction, the Tonic Financial deal, which raised $21 million out of the total amount we said. One big deal and 13 smaller others versus 24 deals that we had in the first half of 2019. Is this normal, a lopsided sort of growth in funding? Number of deals?
Yes, I would say, I mean, if you look at most venture capital data across a host of countries, usually there is one or two deals that really skew the data because if company goes to that $100 to $200 million valuation range, you get funding sizes of anywhere between $20 to $50 million, and that makes it so lopsided versus all these smaller deals which are done within the $1 to $2 million range. Which is quite normal for venture capital.
Mark, I'm very curious from a VC perspective, what are the things that you might be busy looking at today? We know that venture investing in Asia has shifted gears over the last 3 to 5 years from consumer-centric investments to more tech-centric investments. Is the COVID-19 pandemic offering new opportunities, say work-from-home setup, life sciences, or is it still AI blockchain?
I would say that the pandemic has fundamentally changed the entire scene. To a certain extent, in a good way, because it actually rapidly digitalized the entire economy. So anywhere from fintech to proptech to e-commerce, so you saw this huge shift in movement and uptake of all these apps and technology. And for as a venture capitalist, that is such an exciting time, because especially here in the Philippines, you saw it increase so rapidly. Basically, almost every sector in the technology space that we are looking at has been, we are seeing like a 4 to 6 time fold of activity. It's just a very exciting time. And you see that also with suddenly there's so much investor interest here in the Philippines. It's just fantastic.
Mark, you know, I read an interesting article a few weeks back about how normal we think the past normal really is, because normal seems to be evolving and changing. With all these changes from COVID-19, how sticky do you think these will be? And when do you expect us to get back to the normal way of like shopping, working, learning?
I think, to be honest, that first of all, the new normal is not yet defined. I mean, we're still in this shift and changing environment, and nobody knows what really the future will bring. But I don't think that we will ever go back to the past. That will not happen. People have learned how to shop online, bank online, and do all things online. Will not suddenly go back. So I think it's going to have a drastic shift, let's say, in consumer and people behavior. And that will be permanent. Of course, there will be some backtrack. I mean, people will start moving a little bit from online back to offline, if you may call it like that. However, this shift is permanent, and we are personally very, we as Foxmont Capital are very happy with that that change.
Okay, when
it
you
removes,
look,
I mean, just sorry, just want to add, Michelle, it's removing so many inefficiencies here in the Philippine market.
Okay, when you look at what Foxmont Capital invests in, which includes Kumu, what is it that unites your investments? What is it about these companies that interest you that makes you think, okay, this one fits?
Well, I mean, to be honest, we don't have a particular space that we look at. But the thing that is a common denominator is that we only invest in the Philippines. We like investing in young and energetic entrepreneurs. And we love investing in entrepreneurs that can dream big. And we invested particularly in Kumu because we think the founders are just fantastic. And they developed this beautiful and very highly popular online streaming service. And I think what also unites a lot of our investments is that we are targeting, let's say, Gen Z, young people, entertainment, young people education, all targeting basically the new generation of Filipinos.
Mm-hmm. I was going over some of the biggest, the top 20 largest startup transactions over the last few years, from 2018 to 2020. Of course, up on that list would be Voyager Innovations, raising, well, it's over 300, I think, $200 million funds raised. But here's one interesting thing I saw. Goodwork.ph, which is a cleaning service, actually raising $1.6 million. That's around 75 million pesos for a cleaning business. I guess I want to ask you, from a VC perspective, when you look at companies to invest in, I know that you're focusing on Gen Z, but what are some of the things that guide you, that tell you, okay, it looks like this company is going to make it? And what's the success rate for all of these companies, these startups that are funded? Is there like an average success rate?
No, I would not say that there's not an average. I mean, I would say usually what we use in the industry is something like 1 in 10 is
wow,
a hit.
Okay.
I mean, it's not. VC is making small investments. I think that one is a stellar hit. Maybe 3-4 are make at least a profit. Uh-huh. But you can always expect in a VC portfolio that you will also have some companies that will tank and will not make it after 1 or 2 years.
Okay.
And what we look for in most companies is the ability to scale. I think that's the most important thing. Is to what extent can a company start small and keep on growing, and in the end, hopefully become a unicorn. That's that's what we strive for.
Always the search for unicorn. You mentioned scalability. You know, except for the likes of Grab or Gojek, which managed to, you know, become cross-border champions and scale at massive heights, is there a perception that Southeast Asia's ecosystem is a bit more fragmented and therefore harder to scale? Especially when it compares to China.
Yeah, yes, I mean, compared to India and China, where you have populations that all speak the same language, are all relatively homogeneous, and have a population of, you know, 1 billion+ people. Obviously, there are no Southeast Asian comparisons to that. So to that extent, it's really more difficult to scale to those type of levels of population. Then again, if you look at the population of Indonesia or the Philippines, these are very large countries by themselves, much larger, for example, than most European countries.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Overall, are you getting a sense that people are changing their exit strategies as well during this time?
Yeah, you would say that due to Corona and things like that, and to the ability of more private capital, that people are not pursuing any more public listing. However, I think it's still the dream of almost every entrepreneur to eventually ring that bell and go to the stock exchange.
Uh-huh.
So there may be a temporary pause, although valuations are still very high for tech companies. I mean, Nasdaq has only gone up since the pandemic. But I don't think that there will be really a shift in exit strategies. I can imagine, however, for many of the Filipino startups, that they will be gobbled up in the end by some of the larger conglomerates here in the country.
Okay, because my next question is about, you know, do you find that there are some big private companies who are staying private for too long?
Not any, let's say, within the tech space, none come to mind, to be honest.
And final question, capital. Is there more capital to go around, enough capital for everyone to go around now?
There's a lot of capital in the Philippines. It's, however, not all, let's say, put into, let's say, the venture capital space and private equity space. There are very few genuine funds here in the Philippines. I think as Foxmont Capital, we are one of the first genuine independent venture capital funds here in the Philippines. Also, if you look at the different spaces of capital, I think they're, let's say, a startup usually first funds through friends and family. That's up to $50,000 to $200,000. That's usually just done here among, indeed, like I said, the friends and family. And then you have the venture capital funds, especially the foreign ones in Hong Kong, Singapore. And they usually intend to invest, I would say, $1 million and up at least, but their preferred ticket size is 3 to 5. And we try to fill that gap as Foxmont Capital by basically funding that middle between the $200,000 and the $1 million plus.
Okay. On that note, Mark, thank you so much for joining us today.
Okay. Thank you so much, Michelle.